This program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Presents the Devil's Den. Not smoky if it gets in there, not so. But the devil runs it. It's about showing how much life you can take, how crazy you are. You can see that by showing the fact you don't need for suspects.
Albuquerque, New Mexico. Hot, dry, desert air, and sunny skies are common here. More than 300 days of the year. This desert oasis was first settled by the Pueblo Indians thousands of years ago.
The soul of New Mexico is still rooted in that rugged individualism, that we are the people of the land.
But Albuquerque is also terrorized by a gang like no other.
It's a beautiful city, and everybody's the same.
We have a crime problem. We have a violent crime problem.
Behind the violence, a vicious Hispanic prison gang called the Sindicato Nuevo Mexico.
They're killing us. If you don't kill them first, they might kill you.
The mostly Hispanic gang refers to itself as SNM, or simply the S. There are more than 200 SNM members behind bars, a place where they wield even more power than the guards.
When I was stretched off myself, you know, it's always in the back of your mind. You know, the reason why I'm allowed to go home today is because they allowed me to go home today. Because they do have power.
If you disrespect them, I mean, they'll take Earl what they have to take Earl. They'll get them out of the way any way they can.
SNM's reach extends far beyond the prison walls. Their ruthless reputation has built them a loyal following on the streets.
These young gangsters, you know, the street gangs, everybody's all about a reputation, all about a name, all about being a shot caller. So some of your hardcore gang members out on the streets, you know, they do aspire to become a member of a prison gang. You know, it's the big leagues.
The S works closely with street gangs to monopolize the drug trade on the inside and out.
They're controlling the drug activity for that particular area or that body or whatever the case. So these youngsters come into prison, they're coming in still with homeboys still out in the street with contacts there.
The street soldiers funnel a steady stream of heroin, cocaine, and methamphetamine into prisons where the S controls its distribution.
Once you control the drug trade inside of the prison system, you control most everything. There's so many individuals that come into prison that are strung out on drugs, and that's where the money comes in, that's where they can buy their store. That's where they can win favor. Whoever controls the drugs controls the prison system.
Yeah, it was about drugs, and it still is about drugs. There was more in there than what there is out there in the free world.
43-year-old Salvador Jaramillo, aka Chavo, has been in the S for more than 20 years.
I got in it because I seen all the respect they would get. So I wanted the same respect that they were receiving, so I got in it.
Chavo began committing crimes at age 10.
Mainly stealing cars, selling them for money. Back then it was hard to get clothes and stuff, so I would steal to be able to buy my own clothes.
His life of crime earned him 13 years at the maximum security facility in Santa Fe. Inside, the S was waiting.
They beat me pretty bad. I mean, I couldn't even open my eyes.
The gang was testing him.
They let me live, though, because I showed a lot of heart, and they kept telling me to lock it up. But I didn't. I stood out there, and they asked me if I wanted to join, and I did.
Law enforcement considers the S to be a gang of natural-born killers.
Homicide is at the top of the list, there's no question.
They outnumber their rivals 5-1.
They flourish in that environment. They use their ability to scare people, either take their money, bulldog them out of drugs, deal drugs, and just run the prison system.
Only the strong survive in prison, you know what I mean? Then you commit a crime, you're gonna go do time. You better be ready to be a man.
30-year-old Rudy Chavez, aka Soups, is a career criminal. Born and raised in Albuquerque, he was first arrested at age 15.
Well, what I was nervous about, I was nervous about my dad kicking my butt when I got home, no? That's what I was nervous about. I wasn't nervous about going to jail or nothing, you know? Because I seen all my friends and going through that, you know what I mean? And I was part of the process.
After months in a boys' home, Snoops returned to the streets with a vengeance. He pulled off 3 armed robberies before his luck ran out.
I robbed somebody. I robbed him of a gun. I caught him on the ground. And my luck, sheriff passed right by through the spotlight. Red-handed, you know?
Snoops was later convicted of attempted murder, a crime he refuses to discuss.
It's complicated, you know? I really don't want to, you know what I mean, get into that.
Inside New Mexico's Metro Detention Center, he became part of the S, realizing the power in numbers.
We don't like nobody. 90% of the population is Hispanic, you know what I mean? So we don't need to, like, look out for each other. And I'll do anything for them, you know what I mean?
This is Devil's House. Everybody you see in here is a demon. Maybe not by choice, but for survival.
Snake asked to have his identity concealed.
You have to think people in order to know what the next guy's thinking. You have to be ready for it. Because everybody's always planning and scheming and scamming.
He says no one is immune to the wrath of the S, even members.
You get locked up in a cell for a while. Your thoughts are killing miles back and forth. The next thing I hear, I want to kill everybody.
August 26th, 2000. 34-year-old SNM member Matthew Cavalier, aka Mosco, was busted on a parole violation at the Bernalillo County Detention Center. Mosco was housed in general population, along with other gang members.
There's a lot of gang activity in that pod. There's a lot of SNMers there.
Among them, shot caller Gerald Archuleta. Street name, Sticks.
He's a crazy man, it's dangerous.
Mosco was a snitch. 4 years earlier, his testimony had helped convict 2 SNM members in the death of another inmate. Now Sticks, twice convicted of murder, wanted to take him out.
You just don't tell on somebody. You gotta mind your own business. That's the most important thing when you're doing time. Mind your own business and you'll be fine.
24 hours after Mosco's arrival, a local TV station received a tip that he was dead. When reporters called the jail to confirm, the questioning surprised the guards.
We were alerted that way. That's how we discovered it.
Albuquerque, New Mexico. It was once the wild, wild west, and home to America's most infamous felon, Billy the Kid.
The history of New Mexico, too, is part of its appeal. True outlaws and bandits. It's the stuff of legend.
Now, New Mexico's most violent outlaws are locked behind bars. A vicious band of brothers called the Sindicato Nuevo Mexico. Made up mostly of Hispanic inmates, the gang calls itself SNM, or the S. Their roots trace back to the bloodiest uprising in American prison history. February 2nd, 1980. Santa Fe. Convicts inside the maximum security penitentiary. We're fed up with the living conditions.
Some of the things I've seen I'll never forget.
Demon has to have his identity concealed. He says the inmates had managed to make some homemade alcohol and gotten drunk before attacking the corrections officers.
Their guards stripped them. They took away the keys and then opened all the units and took all the guards hostage that they could catch.
Soon, a full-scale riot was taking place, and Demon joined in.
And then we hit the pharmacy. And once everybody started taking pills, that's when the murdering started.
In minutes, 12 guards were taken hostage, and 1,100 inmates had free rein.
They had access to welding torches that were left from a maintenance man. They used those to cut through wires to get two guys ahead and then walk behind him.
Snitches, housed in protective custody, didn't stand a chance.
All the ones they killed were all rats and molesters. Not all the people they killed. They didn't kill my good uncle, you know what I mean?
I seen a decapitated guy, and they were playing bowling with his head. And then later they were carrying the head on a broomstick, walking around the whole corridor. I seen other guys with screwdrivers stuck through their ears, their eyes. I seen guys burnt, black, crisp, charred up their own bodies.
This inmate was doing time for either rape or child abuse, or he was a snitch. There's the inmate. They opened his cell, took him out, and burned him into the floor with the cutting torches. They melted him literally into the floor.
You gotta remember, the rioters had the keys. They cooked them on cell at the time for all of the pebbles. And this guy's sitting there for getting killed. Hear him getting killed. And then he was next. Go down the line.
That's axe marks, where they used to cut into the inmate. They would cut a hand off, cut a foot off, cut an ear off, cut a leg off, and they had the cutting torches to cauterize it so it wouldn't bleed to death. And they kept them alive for 3 days that way. They totally tortured the inmates in here.
The devastation was stunning. 33 inmates were killed. 90 others were beaten and sodomized, including 7 of the 12 guards who were taken hostage. It took the state police and the National Guard 36 hours to regain control.
Many of them had made statements that the brutality of the homicides at the Uncertain facility was much greater than what they had observed serving time in Vietnam.
By then, the Hell House, as the pen was called, was a charred out shell.
The corridor was about a foot deep in red water. My white socks were pink from the blood in the corridor.
The violence continued for about 2 years. 6 more inmates and 2 guards were slain. Guard tower snipers were given shoot-to-kill orders.
After the riot, the killing didn't stop. It went on and on. They brought out a lot of killers. It was a daily occurrence.
The exercise yard of cell block 3 was so dangerous that before entering the yard, each convict had to sign a document releasing the state from liability.
There was shankings, homicides, assaults. It was ongoing. It was continuous, one incident after the other.
A power struggle developed among 2 of the most violent inmates, Ricky Garcia and Juan Baca. Garcia was a charismatic leader with a loyal base of followers. He called his posse the Brothers, or Los Carnales.
If you messed with him, he would kill you.
His rival, Juan Baca, had been a member of the most notorious gang in the country, the Mexican Mafia. He organized 5 other inmates and called them the Sindicato Nuevo Mexico.
He basically mimicked and patterned the model of the S&M as what the Mexican Mafia had in place for years, you know, within the California Department of Corrections.
Baca's gang was small and exclusive.
The people he selected were totally loyal to him. Everything was kept in-house, and anything that was happening in-house was not exposed to anybody else, whether it was the other inmates within the facility or whether it was law enforcement or corrections staff.
The S grew slowly and methodically. By the early 1980s, the close-knit group had only 30 members.
That's what the whole organization was about, protecting each other and helping each other get through your time.
The Department of Corrections, or DOC, attempted to infiltrate the S, but it was too secretive. So in the late 1980s, they tried to end the gang by transferring Baca out of state. Before he left, Baca passed the torch to 18-year-old Angel Munoz, a convicted murderer.
He took him under his wing and he brought him up to par and basically bred him for being a leader and being a shot caller for the S&M.
But Munoz was a heroin addict who was more interested in scoring drugs.
If people were able to supply him with his drug of choice, they were in good standing with him. And many times over, he would allow them membership status as well.
Munoz had just one criteria for potential members. They had to have a drug connection. Membership exploded.
The sindicato was on every yard and every prison. They were the shot callers. They ran the yards. They ran the rackets.
We had roaming rights to everywhere. I took over, I wanted. If somebody did something to me, they would be held to pay. They knew it. We knew it.
I thought I was God just because I was an S&M. I was untouchable.
Salvador Jaramillo, aka Chavo, joined S&M in 1985. For the next 13 years, he did anything the gang asked.
They wanted this guy stabbed, so I did it in the corridor. I waited for him to come out of the unit, and when he came out, I did what I had to do. I stabbed him 37 times. I had 9 days left to get out to discharge, and I ended up picking another 24 years because of that.
He rose quickly through the ranks.
I got a lot more respect. People knew that I was dangerous. They know that I would defend myself no matter what.
By the mid-90s, there were more than 200 sindicato members throughout New Mexico. The DOC found the gang of hardcore killers impossible to control. Rudy Chavez, aka Snoops, made a name for himself when he tricked correctional officers into taking him to a cell block housing enemy gang members.
They asked me where I did, and I told them a different place, and he took me over there. I walked on the floor, and people were playing cards, and they kind of looked, and they saw me, and everybody like, what the hell is this guy doing here? Because everybody knows, they knew who I am.
Snoops paid for taunting his enemies.
I was stabbed like 16 times all over my body, my neck, my ear, my head. They got the best of me. But I wanted them to know that point. Yeah, I got in there. I mean, next time it might be five of us in there.
By 1997, the New Mexico DOC had reached a breaking point. They began segregating their most violent offenders. S&M was among the first to be locked down.
The implementation of the security threat group made prison a prison again. It was no longer just a recreation center.
Seemingly overnight, S&M's stronghold on New Mexico's DOC loosened, but not for long. Angel Munoz was released in 1999, but he refused to give up control of the gang.
He never actually transferred keys. But when he was out of prison and out in the streets, he had certain people he had empowered who were still doing time.
One of those who tried to seize control was Gerald Archuleta, aka Styx. Styx had killed his cousin and his wife, but was sentenced to only minimal time. Now he set his sights on the top prize, and no one would stand in his way.
Somebody you have to keep an eye on. You don't ever want to turn your back on them. If you do, look to the mirror. Make sure you're watching them from behind.
The Sindicato Nuevo Mexico is the most brutal gang in the Southwest. Born out of the most violent prison uprising in American history, carnage is their creed.
You have to have balls. You have to not be afraid of nobody. If somebody pulls a knife on you, you don't run. You fight.
The gang refers to themselves as S&M, or the S. For members, killing is a requirement.
If you want to survive, we kill as many people as you can. Let them know that you're just as serious as they are. At certain times, you have to kill, or you will be killed. And whether you want to be a killer or not, you have to. You know, if somebody calls me out, and I don't do nothing, and everybody's going to look at me as a coward, I'm going to be killed.
BS is run like the Mafia, with a Don at the helm. He rules with a group of long-time respected members called the Panel. Below them, the gang structure becomes military-like.
At the top level, you had your Don. The second level, you had your Godfather. Your third level, you had your General. Under the General, you had captains. Under captains, you had lieutenants. And under the lieutenants, you had soldiers.
The Panel conducts background checks on prospects.
They had to have a very violent history, and they had to have some control of the narcotics drug trafficking trade.
You can't be weak. You don't want no weakness. You can't be a little punk.
Finding new blood is never a problem.
Guessing them is the victim will be because they're the greatest.
You know, they're just recruiting all the time, but they wouldn't recruit anybody.
Many prospects are former street gangsters.
But that guy's an old guy from the streets. And that guy comes in, they say, well, I know him from the streets, I've seen him, this I know he's good. So they bring him up as a prospect. And if he's in another gang, a street gang, he's asked if he wants to come into this prison gang. If you do, you take off that track, you know, and put this one.
This is just old-fashioned recruiting. You're looking out among the ranks to go, who would be better to have in our gang? So when they do get on the inside, they can be our enforcers. They can do our dirty work for us.
Those deemed worthy must then be sponsored in order to join.
The prospect had to be accepted by a panel of anyone who held the rank of lieutenant or higher. And then the final test of loyalty was that the leadership would provide that individual a knife and send him on a mission.
They look for somebody like me. I was, you know, I was willing to kick anybody's ass. I'm here to do my time too. If I have to kick your ass to do it, then I'll do it.
Members are responsible for the prospects they sponsor.
If I screwed up in any way, then they're responsible for me. If I didn't do what they asked me to do, then the ones that brought me in have to take me out.
If you fucked up, that member that brought you up is supposed to take you out, supposed to kill you.
The Sindicato Nuevo Mexico shows allegiance with their ink. Most common is the single letter S or the letters S and M inscribed in a Zia, the ancient sun symbol. The Zia also appears on the state flag.
What S and M is stating when they put the Zia on their tattoo is they own the state.
We're the majority here. This is our state. Chicano, this is our state.
The gang's elders are marked with a tattoo of a three-headed image, symbolizing their Hispanic and Native American culture.
A lot of New Mexicans have roots deep into Mexico, you know, from the Aztecas, and that's what that symbolizes is their culture and who they are. Their ethnicity comes from that of the Latin race and that of the Native American race as well.
SNM remains very secretive.
I was interviewing a SNM member at the county jail. And I asked him, that's your placa or that's your S&M tattoo? Does that stand for S&M? And he's like, no, it stands for Sunny New Mexico.
The gang lives by a strict philosophy. Blood in, blood out.
You only get out if you die. No cowards. If you run, if you coward out, you're dead. You want to see God, we'll take you there. Your death, that's somebody else's yours. And you can get out. Bye-bye.
Members can brand themselves at any time, as long as they're willing to pay the price.
And you put a pink tattoo on, you're telling them, they'll let it. You can do it anytime you want to. The only thing is, they'll call you for a day, but you get to earn it.
SNM's will is law behind prison walls. They police the Department of Corrections, taking out violators of their code. Their favorite targets include rapists, snitches, and child molesters.
Who wants to be around a person that hurts a little kid, you know what I mean? That's disgusting. If I get a chance, I'll get him. You know what I mean? Pulling them by me, I'll get them. No questions asked, you know what I mean? I don't care if I pick up a leg, because I don't care. That's mandatory.
They'll kill him. If they can get their hands on him, or they know any of their brothers that can get a hold of him, they'll send him out to get him.
Snoops assaulted a child molester while doing time for a probation violation.
I reached his door and I got a thing of boiling water, no? I went in there on him, got him with it, no? Smashed him. And I picked up about 5 felonies.
SNM's rule even extends to controlling the guards.
Staff didn't harass us because they were afraid of retaliation. It's like everything is, they open and shut doors, but they don't have control of what goes on after the doors are open.
They use the guards, along with street members, to sneak in drugs by every possible means.
They know the prison system better than we do. We've heard of instances where they'll take a tennis ball, fill it with dope, make a drive-by of the prison and throw it over the walls. They're so ingenious, they can find ways to get drugs in beyond our imagination.
The S are masters at capitalizing on their drug connections.
You get a gram of heroin on the street for $60. You take it to prison and you chop it into 20s, 2 for 50. You make about $900 off of a $60 gram that you buy on the streets.
If you look at some of these people's books, they've had more money on their books than I make.
They knew how to work it. They had alliances.
Heroin is the gang's drug of choice.
It's an escape from the reality. You need something to get you off the everyday violence, or just to have the attitude of don't give a f-. I started doing heroin in prison because it was so crazy. So I blessed someone, they lost it. Maybe I wouldn't wake up.
But the pleasure is short-lived for those who don't play by the rules.
And I seen people get killed for $20. They gave him 2 weeks to pay and he didn't pay, so they killed him.
The violence is just another way. The S dominates the Devil's Kingdom.
I used to hear a nice scream in the nighttime before they would have knocked down. Guys getting beat up, see all scared, they didn't want to go into the dance. But later on, they would go in there and find somebody dead. They're beaten, put up, and almost dead.
New Mexico, 2000. Sindicato Nuevo Mexico member Gerald Archuleta, aka Styx, was working his way up the ranks. Styx was notorious in the S for slipping through the judicial system. After serving just 3 years for killing his cousin, he was released, only to kill his wife.
I can assure you, every time that Gerald came out, it was to build up his base of drug trafficking. And most importantly, maintaining his position as a higher-up in S&M.
But it wasn't enough for Styx. He wanted to take over the S by any means necessary.
He does that through violence and intimidation, and he's damn good at it.
August 27th. Bernalillo County Detention Center. A local television station received an anonymous tip claiming an inmate had been murdered. Officers checked the cell of 34-year-old SNM member Matthew Cavalier, aka Moscow, and found his corpse.
Several dead counts went by before they found him. You know, they just covered him back up with the blankets, like if he was asleep.
He was kind of like face down in a little puddle of his blood, and I did see some shoelaces tied around his neck.
Moscow was a snitch who had betrayed the S.
They caught him already. They knew he had said stuff.
He was housed in general population with other SNM members, including Styx, who took matters into his own hands.
He gave the direct order to go ahead and take out Matt Cavalier, and they complied with his directives.
Once the word goes out that somebody's in a hat, the individuals that are tapped to do that job know that they have to. Otherwise, if they don't do it, they end up in a hat. So hits can happen anywhere, any place inside the prison system.
Moscow's killers manipulated the locks to gain access to his cell.
They would stick playing cards inside of the locks, and it would put pressure on the lock, and the lock would open.
Once inside, SNM showed no mercy.
They stabbed him to death there in the old county jail with a toothbrush, handle, and they strangled him.
The submission home choked him out, had a shoestring right there and tied it around their neck, and not it. They're done. They're not giving up. Wake up.
Inmates were ordered to clean Cavalier's cell. SNM ensured their silence by threatening to kill anyone who ratted. The correctional officers may also have been threatened by the S, which could explain why the murder went unreported for nearly a day.
He's trying to get the out of there. Walking by county and get out of there. They're in a bad position.
Styx and three SNM associates were charged with Moscow's killing. Styx was found guilty in 2002, but sentenced to only 4 years. It was his third conviction for killing.
New Mexico has done a miserable job when it comes to holding violent criminals accountable for their crimes. Turnstile justice has failed our state miserably.
Styx was released in 2005. Just 2 months later, he was back behind bars.
He got into some type of an argument with somebody and walked in and shot up a methadone clinic. By the grace of God, he didn't kill. One of the bullets struck a security guard in the leg.
Former Bernalillo County Sheriff Darren White was furious. He had long sought to toughen New Mexico's three strikes law, which allowed offenders to plead to lesser charges.
That bill has been applied to no one. It has collected dust on the books of prosecutors.
White saw Styx as the perfect example of a much larger threat, the S.
It doesn't matter even if you put them in Supermax. As long as they're still getting out, and as long as they're able to put people back and forth into the streets, they will maintain their grip on this state. And until we take them and put them behind bars and keep them there, they will rain terror on our streets.
White testified before the state legislature, using Styx as the example of why New Mexico needed to change its laws.
I told him it wasn't if Gerald Archuleta would kill again, it's when. Because this is all he knows. He is a violent, ruthless thug. It's unconscionable that a punk like Gerald Archuleta can be convicted of three separate murders, get released from prison and only be out for months and shoot more people. And as we sit right now, we are only months before he's released from prison again.
White's tough talk angered Styx.
Basically, he called this guy out. And when you think about the mentality of S&M, you think about the mentality of the prison system, he's calling him out. So if Gerald Archuleta didn't answer the sheriff, he would look bad in everybody's eyes. So he put a hit out on the sheriff.
Obviously, I must have upset Archuleta to the point where he figured, well, you know, I'm pretty good at this killing business, and this white guy is just a thorn in my side.
In 2007, Styx ordered one of his associates to find someone to kill White. The price tag was allegedly $20,000.
He went to his friend and said, you know, I've helped you out when you were in prison. I've had your back when you were in prison. And he said, I need some help. I need you to help me out with this.
The price remains on White's head.
I get death threats. It's not uncommon. This particular time it got my attention. I know I'm dealing with someone that obviously is not afraid to take someone's life. He's clearly demonstrated that.
Killing a regular man's, you know, maybe ain't that hard, but to kill a sheriff, you know, they really need balls.
S&M's move against White spells trouble. Not only for him, but for the state of New Mexico.
If they're going to start making it one of their behaviors of going after law enforcement, yeah, going after the community is no problem.
For three decades, Sindicato Nuevo México, a ruthless prison gang, has been wreaking havoc.
Prison is no deterrent for them. You know, as a matter of fact, a lot of them are more comfortable inside the prison walls than they are out in the street. But once they hit the street, they get strung out and they go right back into the same criminal activity before they came out.
They have not much regard for life, believe me. They're thugs, and it's all that they know.
In 2007, S&M member Styx targeted former Bernalillo County Sheriff Darren White by putting a price on his head. White took the threat seriously, changing his routine and wearing a bulletproof vest.
Even though I understand there's an inherent risk in being law enforcement, I don't want to die doing my job. And I sure as hell don't want it to be from someone like Gerald Archuleta. Because that's going to aggravate me. That's really going to aggravate me.
Members of ES claim the threat was never real.
Stick still may even have $100. How is he going to have $20,000 to kill a sheriff? And then who is he going to send? Most of these kids don't have the balls to do that. Not the sheriff.
In spite of Darren White's campaign to change the state's three strikes law, Styx is scheduled to be released from prison in 2010.
He will go back to the street, and if anyone crosses him, they will pay. And in Gerald's world, it means they usually pay with their life.
Styx has his eye on leading the S and is raising up a younger, more violent generation of followers called the All-Stars.
All the young ones went with All-Stars. They started talking out with the old and with the new and all that.
I would have to say that right at this point in time that Gerald Archuleta is probably the most dangerous and willing to do whatever it takes because of his violence and because of his personality. You know, the younger generation, they look up to him.
Styx isn't the only S&M gangster looking to run the show. Another notorious member, Ray Baca, a.k.a. Pup, he's emerging.
He's got a lot of rank behind him. He's got a lot of respect behind him. I respect him.
There's some guys that you cannot even explain. They'll create chaos. Oh, yeah. He's one.
Dominating the drug trade is a sure way to assume leadership of the gang.
If you control dope, you control inmates, you know. And Ray Baca definitely does have all the characteristics and traits it takes for the organization to come under one scope once again.
New Mexico authorities see a bloody power struggle shaping up.
In order for the S&M to be united once again, yeah, definitely Gerald Archuleta would have to be removed from the equation.
What worries me, though, is that's the potential for things to get out of hand. You don't get to just walk away from the leadership in a prison gang. You usually pay with your life.
For S&M members, the only way to gain respect is to exceed the terror done before them. It's a vicious cycle that Snake says will never end.
Nobody cares anymore about how you kill people, you know, because if I say I kill somebody, no, to make me for myself. So what? I killed two guys. And the next guy says, so what? I killed three. I killed four. I killed five. You know, so everybody's always, I'm better than that. And he's willing to do more.
It's a violent life. Snake is ready to leave.
I wish that I'd never met anybody from this. I don't like the way they think.
But it won't happen easily.
There's already a green light on me.
Snake says he won't give up without a fight.
I want to live. I'll do what it takes to live. I don't have any desire to take anyone's life, but I will to preserve my own.
Rudy Chavez, a.k.a. Soups, says S&M's growth will only continue.
We're not going nowhere. We're not going nowhere. And I will never turn my back on them. Never. Never turn my back on them.
But he's uncertain as to what lies ahead.
What's next for me is that hopefully I'll never have to be like this ever again. I'm gonna try a different route, try to change it up a little bit. I mean, I am who I am, and that's never gonna change, never.
Salvador Jaramillo, a.k.a. Chavo, claims he's through working for S&M.
They never done nothing for me. You know, nobody's never done nothing for me in there. And that's all I've been doing is picking up time for these guys.
His only hope of leaving the life is moving to California when he's released from prison.
And staying in Albuquerque is not going to happen.
Whatever happens with the S, those on the inside say the devil will have his due.
I don't know where it's going to end up, but we're not going for it. No, exactly. No, I want everybody to know that.
Don't understand me. I'm an uneducated gang member. They're pretty smart and dangerous. The devil's smart. Those are his kids.
Hostage and 1,100 inmates had free rein.
They had access to welding torches that were left from a maintenance man. They used those to cut through wires to get two guys that hadn't even walked the line yet.
Snitches housed in protective custody didn't stand a chance.
Like, all the ones they killed were all rats and molesters. Not all the people they killed. They didn't kill Uncle Rocco, you know what I mean?
I seen that decapitated guy, and they were playing bowling with his head. And then later they were carrying the head on a broomstick, walking around the whole corridor. I seen other guys with screwdrivers stuck to their ears, their eyes. I seen guys burnt, black, crisp, charred up, their own bodies.
This inmate was doing time for either rape or child abuse, or he was a snitch. There's the inmate. They opened his cell, took him out, and burned him into the floor with the cutting torches. They melted him literally into the floor.
You gotta remember, the rioters had the key.
He took him under his wing and he brought him up to par and basically bred him for being a leader and being a shot caller for the S&M.
But Munoz was a heroin addict who was more interested in scoring drugs.
If people were able to supply him with his drug of choice, they were good standing with him. And many times over, he would allow them membership status as well.
Munoz had just one criteria for potential members. They had to have a drug connection. Membership exploded.
The sindicato was on every yard and every prison. They were the shot callers. They ran the yards. They ran the rackets.
We had roaming rights to everywhere. I took all I wanted. If somebody did something to me, there would be hell to pay. They knew it. We knew it.
I thought I was God just because I was an S&M. I was untouchable.
Salvador Jaramillo, a.k.a. Chavo, joined S&M in 1985. For the next 13 years, he did anything the gang asked.
They wanted this guy stabbed, so I did it in a corridor.
Kick anybody's ass. I'm here to do my time, too. If I have to kick your ass to do it, then I'll do it.
Members are responsible for the prospects they sponsor.
If I screwed up in any way, then they're responsible for me. If I didn't do what they asked me to do, then the ones that brought me in have to take me out.
If you f***ed up, that member that brought you up is supposed to pick you out, supposed to kill you.
The Sindicato Nuevo Mexico shows allegiance with their ink. Most common is the single letter S or the letters S and M inscribed in a Zia. The ancient sun symbol. The Zia also appears on the state flag.
What S&M is stating when they put the Zia on their tattoo is they own the state.
We're the majority here. This is our state. Chicano, this is our state.
The gang's elders are marked with a tattoo of a three-headed image symbolizing their Hispanic and Native American culture. And M members, including Styx, who took matters into his own hands.
He gave the direct order to go ahead and take out Matt Cavalier, and they complied with his directives.
Once the word goes out that somebody's in a hat, the individuals that are tapped to do that job know that they have to. Otherwise, if they don't do it, they end up in a hat. So hits can happen anywhere, any place inside the prison system.
Bosco's killers manipulated the locks to gain access to his cell.
They would stick playing cards inside of the locks, and it would put pressure on the lock, and the lock would open.
Once inside, S&M showed no mercy.
They stabbed him to death there in the old county jail with a toothbrush, handle. And they strangled him.
This mission home choke them out, have a shoestring right there and tie it around their neck. Not it. They're done. They're not giving up. Wake up.
Inmates were ordered to
clear. Everybody's always done better than that. And is willing to do more.
It's a violent life. Snake is ready to leave.
I wish that I'd never met anybody from this. I don't like the way they think.
But it won't happen easily.
There's already a green light on me.
Snake says he won't give up without a fight.
I want to live. I'll do what it takes to live. Not that I have any desire to take anyone's life, but I will to preserve my own.
Rudy Chavez, a.k.a. Soups, says S&M's growth will only continue.
We're not going nowhere. We're not going nowhere. And I will never turn my back on them. Never. Never turn my back on them.
But he's uncertain as to what lies ahead.
What's next for me is that hopefully I'll never have to be like this ever again. I'm gonna try a different route. I had to change it up a little bit. I mean, I am who I am, and that's never gonna change. Never.
Salvador Jaramillo, aka Chavo, claims he's through working for SNF. Born out of the most violent prison uprising in American history, carnage is their creed.
You have to have balls. You have to not be afraid of nobody. If somebody pulls a knife on you, you don't run. You fight.
The gang refers to themselves as SMM, or the S. For members, killing is a requirement.
If you want to survive, you kill as many people as you can, let them know that you're just as serious as they are. At certain times, you have to kill, or you will be killed. And whether you want to be a killer or not, you have to. You know, if somebody calls me out, and I don't do nothing, and everybody's going to look at me as a coward, I'm going to be killed.
The S is run like the Mafia, with a Don at the helm. He rules with a group of longtime respected members called the Panel. By 1997, the New Mexico DOC had reached a breaking point. They began segregating their most violent offenders. SNM was among the first to be locked down.
The implementation of the security threat group made prison a prison again. It was no longer just a recreation center.
Seemingly overnight, SNM's stronghold on New Mexico's DOC loosened, but not for long. Angel Munoz was released in 1999, but he refused to give up control of the gang.
He never actually transferred the keys, but when he was out of prison and out in the streets, he had certain people he had empowered who were still doing time.
One of those who tried to seize control was Gerald Archuleta, aka Styx. Styx had killed his cousin and his wife, but was sentenced to only minimal time. Now he set his sights on the top
brother, and they complied with his directives.
Once the word goes out that somebody's in a hat, the individuals that are tapped to do that job know that they have to. Otherwise, if they don't do it, they end up in a hat. So hits can happen anywhere, any place inside the prison system.
Bosco's killers manipulated the locks to gain access to his cell.
They would stick playing cards inside of the locks, and it would put pressure on the lock, and the lock would open.
Once inside, SNM showed no mercy.
They stabbed him to death there in the old county jail with a toothbrush handle. And they strangled him.
The submission home. Choke them out, have a shoestring right there and tie it around their neck. And not it. They're done. They're not gonna wake up.
Inmates were ordered to clean Cavalier's cell. SNM ensured their silence by threatening to kill anyone who ratted. The correctional officers may also have been threatened by the S, which could
have actually discovered.
Albuquerque, New Mexico. It was once the wild, wild west, and home to America's most infamous felon, Billy the Kid.
The history of New Mexico, too, is part of its appeal. True outlaws and bandits. It's the stuff of legend.
Now, New Mexico's most violent outlaws are locked behind bars. A vicious band of brothers called the Sindicato Nuevo Mexico. Made up mostly of Hispanic inmates, the gang calls itself SNM, or the S. Their roots trace back to the bloodiest uprising in American prison history. February 2nd, 19.
You had your general. Under the general, you had captains. Under captains, you had lieutenants. And under lieutenants, you had soldiers.
The Panel conducts background checks on prospects.
They had to have a very violent history, and they had to have some control of the narcotics drug trafficking trade.
You can't be weak. You don't want no weakness. You can't be a little punk.
Finding new blood is never a problem.
SNM is the big blue bean because of the craziest.
Well, they're just recruiting all the time, but they wouldn't recruit anybody.
many prospects are former street gangsters.
But that guy's an old guy from the streets. And that guy comes in, they say, well, I know him from the streets, I've seen him, this I know he's good. So they bring him up as a prospect. And if he's in another gang, a street gang, he's asked if he wants to come into this prison gang. And if you do, you take off that plaque you have and put this one.
This is just old-fashioned recruiting.
I got home, no? That's what I was nervous about. I wasn't nervous about going to jail or nothing, because I seen all my friends and going through that, you know what I mean? And that was part of the process.
After months in a boy's home, Snoops returned to the streets with a vengeance. He pulled off 3 armed robberies before his luck ran out.
I robbed somebody. I robbed him of a gun. I caught him on the ground. And my luck, sheriff passed right by through the spotlight. Red-handed, you know?
Snoops was later convicted of attempted murder, a crime he refuses to discuss.
It's complicated, you know? I really don't want to, you know what I mean, get into that.
Inside New Mexico's Metro Detention Center, he became part of the S, realizing the power in numbers.
We don't like nobody. 90% of the population is Hispanic, you know what I mean? So we need to, like, look out for each other. And I'll do anything for them, you know what I mean?
It's the devil's house. Everybody you see in there is a demon. Maybe not by choice, but...
At the Bernalillo County Detention Center. Musco was housed in general population, along with other gang members.
There's a lot of gang activity in that pod. There's a lot of S&Mers there.
Among them, shot caller Gerald Archuleta. Street name, Sticks.
He's a crazy man, it's dangerous.
Musco was a snitch. 4 years earlier, his testimony had helped convict 2 S&M members in the death of another inmate. Now Sticks, twice convicted of murder, wanted to take him out.
You just don't tell on somebody. You gotta mind your own business. That's the most important thing when you're doing time. Mind your own business and you'll be fine.
24 hours after Moscow's arrival, a local TV station received a tip that he was dead. When reporters called the jail to confirm, the questioning surprised the guards.
We were alerted that way. That's how it actually we discovered it.
Albuquerque, New Mexico. It was once the wild, wild west, and home to America's most infamous felon, Billy the Kid.
The history of New Mexico, too, is part of its appeal. True outlaws and bandits. It's the stuff of legend.
Now, New Mexico's most violent outlaws are locked behind bars. A vicious band of brothers called the Sindicato Nuevo Mexico. Made up mostly of Hispanic inmates, the gang calls itself S&M, or the S. Their roots trace back to the bloodiest uprising in American prison history. February 2nd, 1980, Santa Fe. Convicts inside the maximum security penitentiary were fed up with the living conditions.
Some of the things I've seen I'll never forget.
Demon has to have his identity concealed. He says the inmates had managed to make some homemade alcohol and gotten drunk before attacking the corrections officers.
Their guards got jumped. They took away the keys and then opened all the units and took all the guards hostage that they could catch.
Soon, a full-scale riot was taking place, and Demon joined in.
And then we hit the pharmacy. And once everybody started taking pills, that's when the murdering started.
In minutes, 12 guards were taken hostage, and 1,100 inmates had free rein.
They had access to welding torches that were left from a maintenance man. They used those to cut through bars to get two guys to heaven and walk the line again.
snitches housed in protective custody didn't stand a chance.
All the ones they killed were all rats and molesters. Not all the people they killed. They didn't kill Uncle Rocco, you know what I mean?
I seen a decapitated guy, and they were playing bowling with his head. And then later they were carrying the head on a broomstick, walking around the whole corridor. I seen other guys with screwdrivers stuck to their ears, their eyes. I seen guys burnt, black, crisp, charred up, little bodies.
This inmate was doing time for either rape or child abuse, or he was a snitch. There's the inmate. They opened his cell, took him out, and burned him into the floor with cutting torches. They melted him literally into the floor.
You gotta remember, the rioters had the keys. They cooked them on cell at the time for all of the pebbles. And this guy's sitting there for getting killed. Hear him getting killed. And he was next. Go down the line.
That's axe marks, where they used to cut into the inmate. They would cut a hand off, cut a foot off, cut an ear off, cut a leg off, and they had the cutting torches to cauterize it so it wouldn't bleed to death. And they kept them alive for 3 days that way. They totally tortured the inmates in here.
The devastation was stunning. 33 inmates were killed. 90 others were beaten and sodomized, including 7 of the 12 guards who were taken hostage. It took the state police and the National Guard 36 hours to regain control.
Many of them had made statements that the brutality of the homicides that they observed in the facility was much greater than what they had observed during time in Vietnam.
By then, the Hell House, as the pen was called, was a charred out shell.
The corridor was about a foot deep in red water. My white socks were pink from the blood in the corridor.
The violence continued for about 2 years. 6 more inmates and 2 guards were slain. Guard tower snipers were given shoot-to-kill orders.
After the riot, the killing didn't stop. It went on and on. They brought out a lot of killers. It was a daily occurrence.
The exercise yard of cell block 3 was so dangerous that before entering the yard, each convict had to sign a document releasing the state from liability.
There was shankings, homicides, assaults. It was ongoing. It was continuous, one incident after the other.
A power struggle developed among 2 of the most violent inmates, Ricky Garcia and Juan Baca. Garcia was a charismatic leader with a loyal base of followers. He called his posse the Brothers, or Los Carnales.
If you messed with him, he would kill you.
His rival, Juan Baca, had been a member of the most notorious gang in the country, the Mexican Mafia. He organized 5 other inmates and called them the Sindicato Nuevo México.
He basically mimicked and patterned the model of the S&M as what the Mexican Mafia had in place for years, you know, within the California Department of Corrections.
Baca's gang was small and exclusive.
The people he selected were totally loyal to him. Everything was kept in-house, and anything that was happening in-house was not exposed to anybody else, whether it was the other inmates within the facility or whether it was law enforcement or corrections staff.
The S grew slowly and methodically. By the early 1980s, the close-knit group had only 30 members.
That's what the whole organization was about, protecting each other and helping each other get through your time.
The Department of Corrections, or DOC, attempted to infiltrate the S, but it was too secretive. So in the late 1980s, they tried to end the gang by transferring Baca out of state. Before he left, Baca passed the torch to 18-year-old Angel Munoz, a convicted murderer.
He took him under his wing and he brought him up to par and basically bred him for being a leader and being a shot caller for the S&M.
But Munoz was a heroin addict who was more interested in scoring drugs.
If people were able to supply him with his drug of choice, they were in good standing with him. And many times over, he would allow them membership status as well.
Munoz had just one criteria for potential members. They had to have a drug connection. Membership exploded.
The Sindicato was on every yard and every prison. They were the shot callers. They ran the yards. They ran the rackets.
We have roaming rights to everyone. I took over I wanted. If somebody did something to me, there would be hell to pay. They knew it. We knew it.
I thought I was God just because I was an S&M. I was untouchable.
Salvador Jaramillo, a.k.a. Chavo, joined S&M in 1985. For the next 13 years, he did anything the gang asked.
They wanted this guy stabbed, so I did it in the corridor. I waited for him to come out of the unit, and when he came out, I did what I had to do. I stabbed him 37 times. I had 9 days left to get out to discharge, and I ended up picking another 24 years because of that.
He rose quickly through the ranks.
I got a lot more respect. People knew that I was dangerous. They know that I would defend myself no matter what.
By the mid-90s, there were more than 200 Sindicato members throughout New Mexico. The DOC found the gang of hardcore killers impossible to control. Rudy Chavez, aka Snoops, made a name for himself when he tricked correctional officers into taking him to a cell block housing enemy gang members.
They asked me what I did, and I told them a different place, and he took me over there. I walked on the floor, and people were playing cards, and every time they looked and they saw me, and everybody like, what the hell is this guy doing here? Because everybody knows, they knew who I am.
Snoops paid for taunting his enemies.
I was stabbed like 16 times all over my body, my neck, my ear, my head. They got the best of me. But I wanted them to know that point. But yeah, I got in there. I mean, next time it might be five of us in there.
By 1997, the New Mexico DOC had reached a breaking point. They began segregating their most violent offenders. S&M was among the first to be locked down.
The implementation of the security threat group made prison a prison again. It was no longer just a recreation center.
Seemingly overnight, S&M's stronghold on New Mexico's DOC loosened, but not for long. Angel Munoz was released in 1999, but he refused to give up control of the gang.
He never actually transferred the keys. But when he was out of prison and out on the streets, he had certain people he had empowered who were still doing time.
One of those who tried to seize control was Gerald Archuleta, aka Styx. Styx had killed